Welcome to Chennai Mathematical Institute. STEMS is the Scholastic Test for Excellence in Mathematical Sciences conducted every year as a part of our college fest Tessellate. STEMS is concluded with an online exam in January, from which the top performers are selected for a camp at CMI in February. Today is the third session of the lecture series at CMI as a part of the STEMS campaign. Today's first lecture is by Sridhar Venkatesh. He is second year M.Sc. Math student at CMI. He completed his B.Sc. from CMI itself. Sridhar is also an INMO Awardee. He will be explaining the reasonings behind some of the well-known geometric concepts. So without further delay, I invite Sridhar to start his talk.
Yeah, can everybody hear me? Okay. Before I start, just can you tell me whether you can see whatever I write on the board? Can everybody see? I mean, I want to make sure that people see. If everybody's all right, I'll just go ahead. So what is the, what standard are you in? From 8th to 10th, is it? So I can assume some basic knowledge of, basic knowledge of math at least. Okay, so now can somebody tell me some well-known shapes? Anybody? Yeah, this is, I want to make this as interactive as possible. So, any time I ask something, I feel free to respond. Okay, squares. Okay, let's take a square. Okay, square. Let's say of side length 1. Is that fine? Okay, 1, 1, 1, 1. This is a square. So, you know what the perimeter is, right? Perimeter of this. What is the perimeter of the square? It's just the sum of lengths of the sides. So in this case, the perimeter is 4. What is the area of the square? 1. Or what is it supposed to be? It is supposed to be the side length squared, because it multiplied with itself. Okay, so area is also 4. Well, 1, 1, 1, 1. Thank you. Okay. Now, some other shape now. Sphere. Wait, let's stick to two-dimensional shapes. Rectangles. Okay. So if I take a rectangle, let's say of side lengths, give me any two side lengths. 2 and 5. I hear 2 and 5. So the perimeter is just, again, the sum of the lengths of the sides. It is just 2 plus 5 plus 2 plus 5, which is just 14. The area is 2 into 5, 10. Okay. Now, my question to you is, let's say I scale this diagram by, I double the diagram. I mean, I double the size of the square. Okay. So what do I get? I get a square of side length 2. Then the how let's just see how the perimeter and the area change under this. So what happens to the perimeter? It doubles, right? Because the side length doubles, the perimeter doubles. So let me just write it here. Perimeter doubles. What happens to the area? Increases by 4 times. So if you double the ratio, if you scale the whole figure by 2, the perimeter also scales by 2, but the area scales by 4, which is 2 square. Okay? If I scale the area, if I scale the figure by 3, the perimeter changes by 3. The perimeter increases by a factor of 3, and the area increases by a factor of 9. So if I scale this figure by if I scale this by a number r, then the perimeter scales by a factor of r, and the area scales by a factor of r square. So this is all fine. This is all fine. Yeah. So now let's see the same thing for a rectangle. Okay. Let me not write anything. I'll just ask you questions and you answer me. If I scale the rectangle by 2. That is, I double everything inside. So the if the side lengths are going to get doubled, which means the perimeter doubles. What about the area? 4 times. So irrespective of what the lengths of the sides of the rectangle are, if I scale the figure by a factor of r, the perimeter is going to increase, the perimeter is going to scale by a factor of r, and the area is going to scale by a factor of r square. So now, why stick with squares and rectangles? Okay, let's just do the triangle and then let's move on to the general thing. So if I have a rectangle of side length A and one side length A and the other side length B, what is the area of the rectangle? AB, right? So if I have a triangle, let's say, with base length B and the height H and a height H, what is going to be the area of the triangle? Half BH. Why is that? It's half of a rectangle. How do you see that? Could you repeat it? I don't exactly see what you're saying. So, let's say if I have a general rectangle, a general triangle like this. So, what do you mean by flip? You can come up here, in fact.
But not necessarily, no. But it doesn't have to be like necessary, you know, because for some triangles, the height can be outside the triangle. So technically, yeah, you can't flip it over.
That is true, but let's see what he means by flip it over. Yeah. So when you say flip, can you draw a diagram?
I mirror this side of a triangle in this way.
Okay, but
so it forms a parallelogram.
Exactly, it forms a parallelogram. Why is the area of the parallelogram B into H?
Because if it were a triangle, if it were a rectangle, its area would be B into H. However, its sides are not perpendicular, so you must take H from here.
Yeah, but you're almost there. But okay, let's just be here. So okay, first, does everybody could you just move aside? So does everybody understand his idea about first switching to parallelograms? What he's doing is he's taking the side. He's flipping this triangle. He's getting another copy of the triangle here. Now the whole thing is a parallelogram. And he's saying that, first of all, the area of this parallelogram is twice the area of the triangle. And now the area of the parallelogram, he's saying, is in fact B into H. Okay? So now, now let's see why that is the case. So if we have a parallelogram, let's say, so with the height is H, the base is B. Why is the area of the parallelogram BH?
The area of the parallelogram is BH because if it were a triangle, if it were a rectangle, its area would be AB. In this case, H replaces A.
That's not yet a proof, right? But you're almost there. So let's draw a rectangle with side lengths B and side lengths H. Side length B and H, and see if we can compare the two and say both of them are the same. So can you come here and draw a rectangle which has one side length B and another side length H? Can you draw it here, so then it might be clear. I'll get the duster. Can you draw it here?
Superimposed on the parallelogram.
Exactly. Did you see what he just did? So this is the okay. So let that's correct. You can go back. So I'll just say what he did. So this is the parallelogram. What he did is he just took a rectangle. This is the rectangle which has one side length as H and another side length as B. Okay? What is the area of this rectangle now? BH. Now, can you see that the area of this rectangle and this area of the parallelogram are the same? Why is that? Yeah. Yeah. No, no. So we are proving that. We are in fact proving that. So, exactly. So what exactly is the congruency here?
AAS.
No. That's not what I'm asking. I'm just saying this. The area of this rectangle. Yeah. I'm saying is the area of this parallelogram.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Because the two triangles are congruent.
Exactly. So what the argument is simply this. You can chop this triangle off and just put it here, and from the parallelogram you get the rectangle. That is all. I did not do any calculation. I did not calculate anything. From this you can see that the area of the parallelogram is equal to the area of the rectangle with side lengths B and H. So is it clear now why the area of a parallelogram is BH? So is it clear why the area of a triangle is half BH? Why is that? It's half the area of a parallelogram, and you found out what the area of a parallelogram is. Okay. So these are two shapes you've dealt with. Now, yeah. Okay. Let's say I had a weird shape like this. Let's say some weird shape. Something. How would you attempt to calculate the area of this? Yeah.
You can divide it into boxes. I mean, unit
exactly.
Grids.
Exactly. So, is that clear? So, how would you attempt to even calculate area of such a weird object? You know, for now, you know how to calculate the area of only one type of thing, namely a rectangle. You got other things from that. So say you got the area of a parallelogram or a triangle from knowing how to calculate the area of a rectangle. So that is the only thing you know how to do. So what you can attempt to do is, you can divide this into grids. Okay? Let's say you divide this into 1x1 grids. You can divide this into grids of, say, lengths 1x1, lengths, horizontal lengths 1, vertical lengths 1, and you can calculate how many squares are completely inside the diagram, and you can say the area of this weird shape is approximately 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? Now, you might say, oh, well, you're missing out a lot of the area, you're not actually considering a lot of the, you're just leaving out a lot of space. 4 is not a very good approximation of this, of the area of this shape. So what would you suggest I would do? Exactly, let him answer, yeah.
You can take the left out the grids as half and add them to 4.
That is a good idea, but how do I determine how much portion of, I mean, no, okay, sorry, my question was, what if I want a better approximation of the area? What would I do? Yeah.
Make smaller grid lines.
Exactly. So here, I took grid lines of, say, length 1 and 1. Instead, let me just subdivide the grid further. So I subdivide the grid further. Wait. I am very bad at drawing. You have to forgive me for that. Now you can count how many smaller squares are fully within this. And what is the area of each small square now? 1x4, right? I took rectangles of now side lengths half and half. So now areas of these smaller rectangles are 1/4. And now I can just count how many of them are completely contained. I get a better approximation now. Correct? This is how you would attempt. This is how one would naturally go about attempting to find the area of a weird shape. Okay. Now my question is, what happens if I scale this figure by a factor of 2. Let's say I double the size of this weird shape. What happens to the area of the new weird shape? Yeah. Yeah, can you answer? Area? Area increases by 4 times. So, okay. So, in the case of rectangle, I said you, if you have a rectangle, just double the size of the rectangle, then you said the area increases by a factor of 4. I'm saying, look at this weird shape. Whatever its area is, let its area be something. If I now double the size of this, I'm asking you what does the area change by a factor of? Okay? And her answer is 4. Is the question clear? Let me make sure that the question is clear. Yeah. So, okay, you get what I mean by double the ratio of this weird shape, right? I mean, if I'm drawing this out, I draw it out at double the size. So my question is, if you double the size, why does the area change by a factor of 4? No, area will not. No, that's not true for a rectangle, right? If we had a rectangle, we doubled the sides. What did the area change by? 4. So why are you saying for this weird shape the area should double? If at all anything, it should change by a factor of 4 again, right? No, sorry. By doubling, I don't mean I'm increasing the area by 2. I'm sort of, let's say, both sides, I'm increasing the dimensions by 2. I mean, if I'm drawing this on a graph, if I'm taking, say, 5 boxes to do this and 6 boxes to do this, I instead do this for 10 boxes and 12 boxes.
Yeah.
Okay, is that clear? So, yeah, now why does the area change by 4? Somebody raised their hand.
A square is something which multiplies a number by itself.
Yeah.
In this case, it's 2. So, 2 into 2 is 4. So, it multiplies
no,
by
no,
4.
No, that's not my question. My question is, the area of this weird shape is something. How do I know that if I double the... If I draw this diagram bigger, I mean, you get it, right? I double the size of this diagram. Why does the area change by 4? Yeah.
If we double the total diagram,
huh?
Then the square side will also double.
Exactly, exactly.
So each square will also be get increased by a factor
exactly,
of 4.
Exactly.
Totally the figure gets increased by a factor of 4.
Exactly. So did everybody get his argument? He basically said, my question was this, right? My question was, I just have this weird shape to begin with. I draw it at double the size. Okay? My question was, how much does the area increase by? So his answer, which is very clever, was, you draw a grid to calculate the approximate area of this, right? So you draw a grid. Now, if you double the size by 2, what you can do is you can just double the size of the grid by 2 as well. If you do that, there will be, if there were, say, 6 squares inside here, 6 or 7 squares inside here, there'll again be 7 squares inside if you double the size of the grid. But the thing is, now the sizes of the squares also have doubled. If you had 7 squares inside earlier, you'll still have 7 squares inside in the new figure. But what will the area of each square now be? 4 times. So the total area of the thing is increased now by 4 times. Exactly. So that is the correct answer. So in general, if I have any weird shape, if I, let's say, stretch it out by a factor of r, then the area changes by r square. Yeah.
But what if, like, the whole figure is not covered in square. Say there's some part of the figure is which is only covered like half the square or some unknown.
Yeah, I get your question. So what I'm saying is, if I take finer and finer, if I take smaller and smaller grids to calculate the area of this, I can take the corresponding grid, and if I look at its scaled up version, that still gives you a better and better approximation of the area here. So what do I mean by area of this weird figure? I say my definition is, you take better and better approximation, you calculate the area as a sum, and if this approaches any number, if this approaches any number, declare this to be the area of this area of this weird figure. Now I'm saying, if you have better and better approximations here, those will give you better and better approximation here by just scaling the corresponding grid. Okay. So all this was to say that, the following. If I take which is the one shape we have not mentioned till now? Circle, okay, yeah, I consciously avoided the use of the word. If I take a circle, let's say, of radius 1, let's say. You know what a circle is, right? Please. You know what a circle is, I mean. So now my point is, if the area of the circle is, let's say, is some number A. I don't know what this is. Some number A. If I double the radius of the circle, then my area is going to be 4A. Exactly. Okay, if I scale it by a factor of R, area is going to be exactly. Okay? So R square, area equal to R square. So all I need to now know to calculate the area of a circle is the area of the circle of radius 1. If I know what the area of the circle of radius 1 is, I know what the area of the circle of radius R is. What is it? R square times the area of the circle of radius 1. Okay? So, yeah. I have that and... Okay, now, but since you already know circles, what is the area of a circle? What is the formula for an area of circle of radius r? Pi r square. So, pi is just the area of the circle of radius 1. That's all pi is, okay? Now, you already know that the area of a circle depends on the square of its radius. This constant is just the area of the circle of radius 1. That's all this constant is. But now, that's not the great thing about this constant. The thing is the following. So let's take the circle. Let's say its perimeter or the circumference, let's say C. Circumference is, let's say C. We don't know what it is. Let's say the circumference is C. Let's say radius is 1. If I now increase the, if I double the radius of the circle, what is going to be my new circumference? 2C, right? Because I'm calculating the length of this. If I increase the radius by 2, the circumference increases by a factor of 2. This was okay. In a square, if we a rectangle, if we double the size, then the perimeter is going to increase by a factor of 2. If we scale the square by a factor of r, the perimeter is going to increase by a factor of r. Okay, so in same way for a circle, if I scale the circle by a factor of r, the circumference is going to increase by a factor of r. So, okay. By that I mean, if circumference of, say, the radius 1 circle is C, now the circumference of the radius R circle will just be RC, correct? Now, yeah. So, what did we, let's just summarize what we just said. We just said, circumference depends on, if the radius of a circle is R, circumference depends on R, area depends on R square. As you scale the radius by a factor, the area squares, the area scales by a square of the factor. If you scale the radius by a factor, the circumference scales by that factor. That is all we said. So now, yeah. Now, so again, if you know what the circumference of the circle of radius 1 is, you would know what the circumference of what all circles are. Okay? But, yeah, but you know what, you should know what the formula for a circumference is. What is it? 2 pi r, circumference of a circle, is 2 pi r. So, what is 2 pi then? 2 pi is just circumference of circle. So, this was area of circle of radius 1. 2 pi is just, 2 pi is, by this, it should be circumference of yeah, so now, okay. Now, do you realize that there's something troubling here? Why should the same constant appear in both the cases? Why should the area of the circle of radius 1 be double the area of, why should the circumference of the circle of radius 1 be double the area of the circle of radius 1? Why should they be related? I mean, This could have been some constant and this could have been some unrelated constant. How did it turn out that both of them are in fact related and this is just the double of this? See, that is the main fact about this. The main fact is that, I mean, formula is some formula. That's not the important thing about, say, the circumference, the formula for circumference or formula for the area. The main point is, the constant, I mean, the area depends on the on a constant times R square. The circumference depends on a constant times R. The remarkable thing is that these two constants are related. One constant is in fact twice the other constant. That is the content of all this. I mean, these are very powerful ideas. So that one constant is twice the other is something that has to be proved, right? Now, You agree that this needs a proof. I mean, if somebody said this, you should not accept this because somebody is saying it. I mean, you better not do that, okay? So let's prove the statement. Okay. Now I want somebody to say what we need to prove. If somebody says that, I'll go ahead with the proof of whatever we need to prove. Okay? Yeah.
We need to prove that the circumference of a circle of radius 1 is twice the area of a circle of radius 1.
Exactly. So you get his point, right? You just need to now, so we have a statement. Let's say statement. Circumference of a circle radius 1 is equal to 2 times the area of a circle okay. You realize that this is a statement that needs a proof. I mean, if somebody said this to you, you should ask why, because this is a priori a weird statement. I mean, why does this have any reason to be true? Okay. So the rest of the talk will be to try proving this, okay? So how would you go about doing this? Yeah.
The ratio of circumferences to diameter is pi, so...
No, we don't know that. That's what I'm saying. So, let's say we were in, whatever, 2000 BC or something, when we don't yet know this.
Oh, okay.
I mean, see, because that's the thing, right? That was the discovery of... not Euclid, wait. Who's that guy? Archimedes, yeah. I think that was the discovery of Archimedes. That, or somebody, I mean, there's Wikipedia, I could be wrong. I mean, you can just check. But that is the remarkable fact. I mean, the formulas are just a consequence of this single fact. The formulas are secondary. You can treat them to be, I mean, something that you have to learn. This is the fact from which everything follows. And this, you realize, needs a proof. I mean, this is not a... I mean, this is... Somebody is claiming that and they better prove it when they make a claim. So, yeah, how would you go about doing this? Oh, what do we know the area of? What shapes did we know the area of? Square? Rectangles? Triangles. So, let's stick with triangles. Our hope is, if we can approximate the area of a circle of radius 1... by triangles, we can perhaps relate the circumference to the area. Let's try. Let's just see what happens. So everybody is clear what our aim is now. Let me just go about proving that. Okay. Let's say you have a circle of radius 1 now. Does this look like a circle? Sure, okay, why not? Yeah. So what I'll do is I'll subdivide this into triangles. So let me just do this neatly. So, let's say... Or let's first stick with 3, no? Why am I drawing 6? Let it be 6, okay. This is a very, very bad diagram. This is supposed to be a regular hexagon. You know what a hexagon is, right? 6 sides. All of these triangles are supposed to be same, but my drawing skills are not very good. Okay. If we, we've now inscribe this hexagon inside a circle. So let's calculate the area of this hexagon. We can actually do that. So if the side lengths are 1, let's say the length of this is let me call it B6. Just a name, any name. I can give it any name. So all these lengths are B6. All these lengths are equal. They're all B6. Okay, the radius is 1. So let me call the height of this rectangle as H6. Okay, the 6 will be clear. I'm writing 6 will be immediately clear, and because it's a 6-sided thing, that's not important. But if I take the height of this triangle to be H6, now can somebody tell me, what is the area of, say, this triangle? Area, so let me call this something, no? Or let me just write area of this triangle. Simpler.
Half into H6 into B6.
Exactly. So area of this triangle is just half into H6 into B6. Okay? But we want the area of the hexagon. So therefore, area of hexagon... is just, yeah, so let's just write 6 times this. So there are 6 copies of the triangle. Area is just 6 times this. I mean, pardon my drawing skills. 6 into half into H6 into B6. Okay? Now, let me bring the 6 this side. So let me just write this as half into H6 into 6 times B6. Why did I do that? This is shit. This is very bad writing. Okay. 6B6. Okay. Now, what is 6B6? perimeter of the hexagon. So this is just half H6 into, let me write, perimeter of hexagon. Okay, that's fine. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Now, let's say I can't draw this. Let's say instead of 6 sides, I had 8 sides. Imagine this, because my drawing skills are very bad. Imagine you had 8 sides instead of 6 sides. So what would the area of the octagon be? So, no, in terms of the last line, okay, it would first be half. So it would just be area of one of the triangles, if there were an octagon, would be half H8, B8. But you have 8 copies of the triangle, so area of the octagon would be 8 times this. Again, now just taking the 8 here, I get this as half H8 into 8B8, which is just exactly half H8 times perimeter of octagon. Okay? Okay. Everybody is okay with this. I mean, if somebody has any problem, you should stop me and ask, because I might fool you, I don't know, okay? Yeah, now can somebody guess what I'm doing? I mean, what is my next step? Yeah.
Increase the number of triangles to
12 or 15. Yeah, okay. So, let me actually try drawing this, okay? If it doesn't work out, we'll go back to formulas and equations. Let's say I take a 1,000-sided polygon, okay? What I'll have is, I'll have very, 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 very small triangles. So, I would have divided this into very, very, very small triangles, and still, area of, say, I don't know what the 1,000-sided polygon is called. Let's just call it 1,000 gone. Area of 1,000 gone will just be half into H1,000 into perimeter of 1,000 gone. Perimeter of 1,000 gone. Yeah, but where am I going with this? What is, yeah. I can take more and more sides.
As you increase the number of triangles, the side of the circle starts becoming like a line, and the base of the triangle becomes almost equal.
Exactly.
To that part.
Exactly. So does everybody get what she's saying? She's saying, as you take more and more sides, your polygon is sort of approaching the circle. So, okay. So, let's see. So, let's say if I take an n-sided polygon, I have on one side area of, let me call it n gone, equal to half into hn into perimeter of n gone. Okay, so as n becomes larger and larger and larger, this becomes, what does this become? No. What does the area of the n-gon become? No, don't say pi r square. It becomes the area of the circle. So it just, area of, as n becomes larger, area of the n-gon becomes, area of the n-gon goes closer and closer to area of the circle. Okay. What about this side? As n becomes larger and larger, first, what does the perimeter of n-gon become? Circumference of the circle. So let me just write it here. Circumference. So this is the last factor. what does the height become? Radius, is that okay? Okay, so now I write half times radius. But radius is what? 1. So what do we have? So what did we just do? We proved that the area of a circle of radius 1 is? Yeah, so we proved this. I mean, was this hard? Like, please tell me this was not hard. No, I mean, you don't have to, but was it hard? It was not hard. So from this now, you can derive your formulas and whatnot for the circle, whether the formula of its radius or its, sorry, formula of its circumference or formula of its areas. So now, after you've done this, now you can say, let pi be the area of the circle of radius 1, or equivalently, let pi be the circumference of, half the circumference of the circle of radius 1. Now you can, estimate pi by, taking a measuring tape and wrapping it around the circle of radius 1, take a better and better measuring tape, whatever, it doesn't matter. That's, what pi is not the important thing. What is important is that last fact. Okay. Now, let me just erase this. Okay. Okay. Now that I've erased this, I want somebody to recreate the proof. Somebody to just retell the whole thing. That is why I erased it first. Okay. Can somebody? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So in a circle with radius.
Yeah. So first, what did we try to prove?
We tried to prove that the area is half the circumference.
Yeah.
Of a circle of radius.
Yeah. Yeah. So what did we do?
We drew a circle and drew triangles. For example, 6 triangles.
Huh?
From the center,
huh,
with side length 1, huh, and base length as B6.
Yeah.
And say that the height was H6.
Yeah.
We finally concluded that the area of that figure of 6 sides, the hexagon, was,
yeah,
half into the H into the perimeter,
yeah,
which is 6 times,
yeah,
the base. And so as we kept drawing more and more triangles,
exactly,
we started, the bases started becoming smaller and smaller.
Yeah.
And so as we drew like about 1,000 triangles, the length of the base, the perimeter of the figure almost became equal to the circle.
Exactly.
And so since the area is half times the height times the perimeter.
Hmm.
So now the area has also become related to this. Circle.
Exactly. And it is related by a factor of half. That is just something that comes out of the equation.
Yeah.
So everybody is okay with this. Do they do this in schools? I don't know. When I was in school, they didn't do this. No. Okay, good. To something new, I guess. Okay. Now, why is this idea powerful? Because, what is the next question? Okay. Again, I go back to my first question. What are some other shapes, you know? Somebody said something that time. Sphere. Somebody said sphere. So now, how would you go about estimating the size of a sphere? Yeah. The main point is this idea generalizes.
Huh. I'll start with a three-dimensional figure with four vertices for each face.
Okay.
Then increase the number of vertices, it will become a dodecahedron, then 12-sided.
Yeah, that will be complicated, but okay. So basically his idea is, you have a sphere, right? So what would you do now? You would say, take cones. So here you would take triangles, right? In the sphere, take cones, and as you make the radius of the cone smaller and smaller, you can use the same trick to calculate it. But that will be computationally slightly hard. But so what we do is, we do the following. But the idea is similar. So we'll estimate the size of the hemisphere and then we double it. So let's say we have the hemisphere. No, it's a bad diagram. Okay. What we now do is, we take... We take cylinders... Is the diagram clear? We take cylinders, yeah, of slightly smaller radius, stack them up on top of each other. Then what we do is we reduce the height of the cylinders. So when you first say, let's say stack up by, let's say you first stack up by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cylinders, then of all the same height, let's say. So you would now calculate the area of the volume of the hemisphere in terms of the volumes of these cylinders. So then what would you do? You would reduce the height of this. Instead of taking it of this height, let's say if you halve the height, you would then approximate it by 10 cylinders. And then as this becomes larger and larger, you would be able to estimate the size of the sphere in terms of the volumes of these cylinders, and you would get a similar answer. But Yeah. So my main point is, the idea is just this. You approximate it by areas or volumes of things you know, and then if you can make finer and finer approximations, you get better and better answers. So this is essentially what we did with the grid. What were we doing with the grid? We were trying to estimate the area of the of an unknown figure with the help of known shapes. Okay. Yeah.
No, I'm not sure, but then I have a doubt. Huh. This thing, we know that the circumference of a circle is 2 pi r and area is pi r square, no?
Yeah.
So, but then why use pi out of all the constants?
No, that's just the name. They could have called it anything.
No, like why use 22 by 7 in the sense, instead of out of all constants?
No, you realize you don't have a power over what the constant is. See, the constant, okay, so let's say area of a circle is in fact area of circle of radius 1 times r square. You agree with this, right? This we derived in the course of the talk. Area of a circle is area of circle of radius 1 times r square. Now, you don't have any, nobody has any say over what this is. This is God given. I mean, this, whatever the area of the circle of radius 1 is, that is the constant. It turns out that the area of the circle of radius 1 is in fact actually 3.14159 whatever. Is it okay? I mean, if not, you can ask. The basic point is, area of a circle is some constant times r square, and that constant is area of circle of radius 1. And they call this number pi. Whatever they call it is irrelevant. They could call it anything else they wanted. The quantity is just the area of circle of radius 1. That is the important thing. Okay. Yeah, does anybody have any more questions? If not, I have... Okay.
How is the value of pi derived?
So as I said, there are various ways. One straightforward and simple way to do it is take better and better measuring tapes, calculate the volume of a calculate the circumference of a circle with your measuring tape. Okay, what should the circumference of a circle of radius 1 be? 2 pi, right? Now if you take a very good measuring tape which goes up to decimals and measure the circumference of a circle, you should get whatever value you get, you divide by 2, that should be a very good approximation for pi. But that is a bad answer. Let me just say this. Pi occurs as a quantity in certain other equations where you can get better and better approximations for it. What pi is a fixed quantity. It is this. It is area of circle of radius 1. This is the precise definition of pi, if you will. But if your question is how can you measure it better and better, that is, you can get nice equations which contain pi in them and measure them. Or if you want a practical approximation for it, as I said, take a measuring tape, measure it, you get it. I mean, that's all I can say. So does anybody have any more doubts? Yeah, please feel free to ask. Okay. If not, I think I have to stop in 10 minutes. Yeah, I'll quickly outline another proof for what I just did, so that that is useful in certain other ways. Okay. Yeah. So this is another proof for the state, for which statement? Area of circle of radius 1 is equal to half the circumference of circle of radius 1. I'll just give you another proof of this statement, which is useful in its own ways. What we can do is the following. Okay. Let's take the circle of radius 1. Okay, this is a radius 1. Okay. Now, let h be some other number. I can take the circle of radius 1 plus h. Okay. H is this distance. Okay, this is a circle of radius 1 plus h. This is a bad diagram. Okay. What is this? Okay. So now, area of, let me say, bigger circle. No. So my question is, area of bigger circle is, let's say, yeah, what is it? In fact, you can tell me. So I'll call this, instead of writing out area of circle of radius 1, let me just call this number A. I mean, it is pi, you know it is pi, but let me just call this number A, okay? So area of bigger circle is area of circle of radius 1 into area of a circle is area of circle of radius 1 into the radius square, right? So A into, exactly, A into 1 plus h square. What is the area of the smaller circle? Area of is A by definition. That is what I call the area of. So now then, what is the area of this small band? Exactly. So let me just write area of band equals A into 1 plus h square, outer area minus inner area minus A. So what is the identity for 1 plus h square? This you know, right? I mean, how old are you? I don't know. What is the expansion of 1 plus h square? Do you know? Okay, nice. Great. That's great. Oh, when do they teach? I don't know. I've forgotten. Huh? Oh, okay. That is early. Okay. 1 plus h square plus 2h minus A. So what do I get? I get A plus AH square plus 2AH minus A. So A and A cancel. I get AH square plus 2AH. Okay. Okay. Let me just have that by the side. Okay. Now what is my point? My point is, the area of this band, actually, can I erase the top part? Okay. Sixth standard, seriously? No. They teach you this in sixth standard. Seventh. Seventh. Okay. Wait. Okay. Okay. Let me write area of the band here. Now, I want you to give me, say, bounds for this area. Let me be precise. You have this area of the band. Now, can you give me, okay. Imagine I cut this out here. This is a band, right? I cut this out and I spread it out and I lay it out flat. What do I get? Trapezium. You get a trapezium. You don't get a rectangle. Because if I cut it out, the outer length will be more than the inner length. So let's say I cut it out here. I lay it out flat. I get something like... Does everybody agree that this is the thing I get if I cut it out and laid it out flat? That's all right. So with the height being h, so the height is h. And what is the length of this side, the bottom side? Oh, sorry, I shouldn't write. Sorry, what is the length of the bottom side? Circumference of which circle? Bigger circle. So circumference of bigger circle. Similarly, this is circumference of smaller circle. Okay. Now, this area of this trapezium, can you give me two bounds for it? Okay, let me draw this to make more suggestive. Make it more suggestive. So, area of this trapezium is bounded by what? Area of which two diagrams? It is certainly bigger than the area of this smaller rectangle. And it is... Area of the band is certainly smaller than the area of the bigger rectangle. So, area of the band is lesser than or equal to area of the bigger rectangle, which is just? Exactly. Circumference of bigger circle into height, and it is certainly greater than or equal to circumference of smaller circle into height. Okay. Yeah. So, oh shit, I erased it. Okay. What was the area of the band? What is the area of the band? Yeah. A h square plus 2ah. So what is the circumference of the bigger circle? Well, what is the circumference of a circle? Circumference of a circle is circumference of a circle of radius 1 into radius. Okay. Let me write. So again, C, I'll call it as circumference of circle of radius 1. Just like how I called A as the area of circle of radius 1, I call C as the circumference of circle of radius 1. So in that case, I'll just have, what would this be? So what is the circumference of the bigger circle? C into radius, right? So C into, what is the radius? 1 plus h into h. And on this side, I'll have circumference of the smaller circle, which is just c, because it's the circumference of radius, circumference of circle of radius 1, c into h. Let me write c into 1 into h. Okay. Can I just cancel h throughout? I can, right? I have h common throughout. H is positive. I can cancel it throughout. So let me cancel H throughout. What do I get? I get C less than or equal to AH plus 2A less than or equal to C into... Okay, is everybody with me so far? Is everybody with me so far? Now what happens if H becomes smaller and smaller? No, in this equation, what happens in the picture if H becomes smaller and smaller? The bigger circle becomes a smaller circle. So, what happens in the equation? What does this become? H becomes smaller and smaller means h goes to 0. So this thing becomes 2a. What does this thing become? No. C into 1 plus h. H becomes 0. This becomes? So what do you have? You have C. And so? This inequalities they have taught. No, 6th standard they have taught a square plus b square. This they have taught definitely. So this just means what? What if C is less than or equal to 2a, less than or equal to C, that means C equals to 2a, right? I mean, this is okay, right? So that means C equal to, which is what we started out. Circumference of the circle of radius 1 is twice the area of circle of radius 1. So why did I do this method? And this will be my final thing. So why did I do this? Because of the following homework that I can give you. Yes. Can do this. Yeah. Now the exercise for you is use this same method to get some relation between area of sphere of radius 1 and volume okay. The question is clear, right? What would your guess be? Well, what did we have if instead of sphere you had circle of radius 1 and so in the case of circle, this was circumference of circle of radius 1. This was area of circle of radius 1. Now we have increased the dimension. We have area of sphere of radius 1. We have volume of sphere of radius 1. What would you guess the relation would be? So let me just write what it was. No, so let me not write equal to. I had circumference of circle of radius 1 here. I had area of circle of radius 1. So what was the relation I had here? This was equal to? No, twice, right? This was equal to twice the area. So can anybody like randomly guess whatever you can think of? Huh? 4? No? 8? No? 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 Yeah, who said 3? 3 is correct. This would be 3. And this is not mysterious. I mean, there is a very good reason why this is the case. But try using the same method. So, okay, as a last thing, can somebody just tell me how you would go about doing this statement? Inspired by the last thing I just did. Does somebody volunteer to express it? You can just suggest it. I mean, I will not write it out. How would you do it? Yeah.
This, as you said earlier, that sphere, it's a three-dimensional shape.
Yeah.
And that has been reduced further as a cone, said by you.
No.
We'll
no,
go
not
along
this.
With that method, then we can derive.
That method we can do, but I said this. I showed you the last method because you can, say, generalize it to higher dimensions.
We need to guess further.
No, yeah. So, can you? Yeah, can you?
Hmm. If we increase the radius by some x,
huh?
And we take previously in two dimensions we got a band.
Yeah.
But I conjecture that in three dimensions you'll get a frustum.
What is a frustum?
Truncated cone.
You will get not exactly a frustum, but almost a frustum. So he's but you're correct. So in the case of sphere also, see one thing. I couldn't draw circles properly, so I can't draw spheres properly, okay? That is a fact. If I have a sphere, what I can do is, just like how here I took a circle of slightly bigger radius, I can just take a Yeah, slightly bigger. I can just take a slightly bigger sphere, and now I can see what happens as I take the limit test, as the bigger sphere goes to the smaller sphere. And if you try this out, you'll in fact get this. Okay? I guess I will stop here. So anybody, any questions about anything?
Circumference of a circle of radius 1 is 2 pi. Area of circle of radius 1 is pi. So shouldn't the 2 be the other way around? Shouldn't it be 2 circumference of circle of radius 1 equal to area of circle of radius 1?
No, sorry. No, right? This will be 2 pi, so that will be 2 times pi. Okay? Yeah, this will be 2 pi, that will be 2 times pi. Yeah. Any questions? I have a question. Like, why do they teach it in class 6? Like, what?
Good question.
Yeah, okay. Questions or anything? Oh, shit. Nothing, huh? Okay. Nice. Okay, done.
Yeah, so let's thank Sridhar for this amazing talk. All the concepts he introduced were really intuitive. We hope you had fun with shapes. So, thank you.
Check out the outside the box geometry course. You will have fun solving folding puzzles, mastering triangles, and tessellating with reptiles.